Hello, and welcome to Family Matters. I'm Dr. Mariana Martinez, your host. I have yet to encounter parents who do not agree that having a united front, that is, to be in agreement when addressing children's issues, is a good idea. It just makes a lot of sense, right? Well, my guest today will challenge this principle. She believes the so-called united front approach in parenting might present a problem for both the adults and the children in the family. In this edition of Family Matters, we explore the other side of the coin, one that is often out of sight. Lorna Hecht is a licensed marriage and family therapist who has a private psychotherapy practice in San Diego, California, where she applies her knowledge on Bowen family systems theory. Rather than working directly with children, Lorna coaches parents when they have difficulty with parenting or when they are concerned about their children's behavior. The topic of the united front approach usually comes up. Lorna, welcome to Family Matters.
Thank you.
And thank you for the long trip from San Diego.
Mm-hmm.
I'm glad you're here. So let's start by defining what is this so-called united front approach?
So the united front would be the idea that mother and father would agree about what's happening with the child and that they would agree on a consequence if there's a punishment or discipline.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it really sounds logic. Do we want to fight and be in different camps all the time? How come you are challenging this idea, or where does that come from?
It's true. Parents worry, what if we fight in front of the kids? That would be terrible. We should agree in front of the children. And I'm sure I agreed with that idea. And then several years ago, I came across an article by Dr. Bowen. He actually wrote it in 1972, and the title was, Parents Should Not Provide a United Front. So that's eye-catching,
mm-hmm.
right? And so he made several points in this article that really did change my way of thinking about the best way to handle a problem in the child. And one problem is that in the family triangle, mother, father, and child, if the parents get together and agree, then the child is, sort of on the outside of that and facing two big people. That can be a little bit overwhelming. The child really may feel outnumbered or ganged up on. And sometimes that can lead to compliance on the part of the child, but just as often it can lead to rebellion and more acting out down the road.
So what would be the option then? To side with a child, then what to do?
So I think that whichever parent is encountering the difficulty is best off getting very clear on his or her own thinking about the problem and how the problem should be handled, and keep it between that parent and the child.
Okay, so let me clarify just one thing. You're not saying that it's not all right to have an agreement with parents, is that correct? I mean, when they actually agree, what if it happens that they do agree with something, the child didn't have his meal, so he won't have dessert.
Sure. So, again, in most situations, there'll be one parent who's kind of taking the lead. It may be the one it's probably the one who's there, but even if both parents are there, one might be more of the driver of mealtime, for example. And that one adult, big grown-up person, should logically be able to handle the situation with the child. Whether the other parent agrees or not, they can step back.
So you're saying that it's not a matter of challenging the other parent's decision, but you don't have to add up to the pressure, let's say. Is something like that?
That's a great way of saying it. One doesn't need to pile on.
Mm.
One of the problems, I think, with the united front is when the one parent asks for the other one to pile on, to join in, they're actually undermining themselves and their own authority. you know, I'm not capable or strong enough to handle this situation with this 5-year-old, 7-year-old, 13-year-old. I need backup. Mm-hmm. And so that's really, rather than projecting an image of strength and competence and confidence, it's actually undermining one's own argument.
That reminds me of a comment that a couple made to me not long ago, a couple of weeks ago. The mother was describing a situation where the child was playing something and they had to leave because they had to go visit an aunt or something boring like that. And of course he didn't want to go. So she was, the father had gone out and brought the car down in the apartment. There was this little place to park. So he was waiting on the street and he calls, "I'm ready down here." And she was telling, "Come upstairs. I just can't make my son come down. And I need you to support me in saying it's mm-hmm. time to go." Mm-hmm. And the father, I think that maybe just naturally thinking about this, said, "No, I shouldn't go upstairs. Just do it yourself. You can do it." And she was able to do it, of course. A little rough, and it was not an easy one. But the father was not sort of piling, as you put it, on and allowing the mother to do what she needed to do. Is this something that you're thinking about?
I think that's a good example. One way that might go pretty typically is that the child doesn't want to go, mom's getting frustrated and aggravated, and then she, you know, would get that call from father, and her frustration and aggravation would go through the cell phone into him, and then he'd be agitated, and then he might be more likely to come up, you know, sort of loaded for bear, overreacting. And because his, you know, he caught the anxiety from his wife and it became even more amplified. And that's when a situation, on the one hand, you might call it a united front, but on the other hand, you might call it a bit of a tsunami overwhelming the child.
Yeah. So what you're saying is, rather than let's not agree, which I think is not what you're saying, is have each parent be enough of a parent or be capable of being fully a parent without the need of the support of the other.
Yes, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. And in what idea in Bowen theory, you said you read this in an article, so therefore there is some theory behind these ideas. What would be the theory behind this idea?
Well, it's interesting because most of that article, actually, Dr. Bowen is focusing on the I position and taking an I position with the child and developing a one-to-one relationship with the child. And that definitely fits in with theory. Rather than going through the triangle, you know, mm-hmm. wait till I tell your father or your mother's going to be very disappointed in you. This is between you and me. And it's a part of a larger relationship that you and I share, and I can be open and direct with you with my thinking and what I'm planning on doing or not doing if the situation between us doesn't improve.
Now, I bet that you find this all the time, that one parent thinks one thing and the other parent thinks a different thing. Like they think that the way to handle a certain situation should be is different among them. So in what context that gets discussed or agreed upon or not necessarily, what's your view?
Well, you're bringing up something very important. The other problem with the United Front is it's superficial. That in any topic a person can think of, you take two people and if you dig far enough, you'll find the differences in opinion and differences in perspective. And children are real good at knowing where that line is and exploiting it. So the United Front always has cracks in it, and those will be revealed. Now, I think it's fine for parents to discuss their differences. And it's also fine for mother to handle a situation one way if this is her episode with the child, and it's perfectly fine for father to handle it a different way if he's in charge at that moment. And children are more than capable of developing different and distinct relationships with all of the people in their lives.
But don't you think that opens the door for the child playing out the parents on, like, doing one thing with one and doing a different thing with the other, and then creating the conflict between the parents, or just getting their way because mom allows me to do this, so I'm going to ask her to do that if I could do that, and then dad, I would ask dad different things because he would say yes, or something like that?
Well, sure, and you really are talking about the triangling process, and I would say that children aren't the only ones in the family who play one off against the other, mm-hmm. that every family member does that, and the more the parents do that, so that would maybe look like mom complaining to the children about father, or mom and dad getting together to complain about the child, the two-on-one. The more the family does that as a coping style, as a way of managing the anxiety in the family, the more the child's going to pick up that same way of mm-hmm. managing situations.
Hmm. It's so different. This idea is so different than what we have heard across the board. That how do you see parents using this? Is this really something they can grab onto and use in their everyday life?
One thing that I've really seen in my clinical practice is when I start talking to people about this idea, pretty quickly one will pick up the effort to, if there's an interaction between the child and the other parent, stay out of it. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting to see which one of the two who are in conflict will try harder to pull in the other parent, because that's part of triangling too. I think that's a lot of what the conflict between parent and child in the home can be, is an attempt to get the other parent involved. So when the other parent refuses and says, I'm out of this one, hope you guys work this out, mm-hmm. it tones down more quickly.
But often then the parent who is left with a problem with dealing with a child feels, I think, like not supported, and that you're not on my side, telling the other parent you're not on my side, you're not supporting what I have to do, I always have to take care of this on my own, you're disengaged. I hear that a lot, so how do you explain this, or are there ways to be disengaged and that are more constructive than others?
Well, certainly there's a big difference between thoughtful disengagement and reactive or anxious withdrawal. Mm. On some level, those might look the same in a particular situation, but they don't feel the same to the system. You're also getting into what this is really all about. You and I are talking about how to manage self with the children, but really the united front is about the marital dynamic. Hmm. And so when a parent is saying, you're not supporting me, that has much more to do with the two adults than the child. It's almost like the situation with the child is being used to make a larger point.
How, I'm sure that you also hear this complaint a lot, that the one parent undermines the other parent. And if the father says, no, you need to go to bed now, then the mother on the other side could say, well, but just come here and sit with me for a little while, and then you'll go. So that's having a different opinion, but I don't feel that that is constructive or useful either. So
yes, I don't even know if that really is having a different opinion, or it's just a way of operating in the triangle, an automatic reactive way of operating in the triangle, although of course people may have different opinions. And I would absolutely say that while one may not agree, actively sabotaging the other parent is a problem. It's marital conflict playing out at the expense of the child.
You always bring it back to the marriage. It seems to be the crux of the issue here.
Although I will say this, that particular scenario, boy, do I hear about that a lot with parents and grandparents. Uh-huh. And that a grandparent will often jump in on the side of the child or in the softer position and frustrate the parents endlessly. But I think it takes some self-control and some confidence to know that one's own eye position has value if calmly stated and consistently maintained, even if the system does sabotage you in some way.
So the example of the grandparents, you have to do your homework for half an hour, and the grandma says, come on, just let, he can play a little longer and then he can do homework or something to that effect. What would be the using this idea of being a self, I think that's what you're saying, being a self with a child would look like in this case, as a mother and as a grandmother, who honestly the grandmother thinks it's too harsh, and honestly the mother thinks it's time for him to do homework. So
It's interesting. I think if mother was the main operator there, you know, she has every right to say, ugh, grandmas just want to have fun. Of course, grandma wants to spend more time just reading with you, but I already said it's time for your homework, and you two can, you know, play after you're done with your homework.
And then you don't think it is useful to then talk with mother and say, you know what, when you do this, it makes it harder for me to parent my child. Is that conversation appropriate?
Maybe, but you know, getting reactive about it will not be particularly helpful. If a thoughtful comment, in addition to the stand that was just taken, which is kind of self-explanatory, a thoughtful conversation could happen, sure.
Do you have an example of a family that you have worked with who was engaged very strongly in this way of parenting? We need to be in agreement all the time. If we don't agree, I'll say yes now, and then we can discuss it later. We have to have the same rules all the time, like that sort of parenting that then moved towards the more individualized, if you will, parenting style?
I think the more often what I see is one parent saying how it's supposed to be, and then the other parent reluctantly, half-heartedly going along. Mm-hmm. On one level, it looks like a united front, but on another level, it really isn't. And of course, the children, they can smell that, you know, a mile away. I think that's a more common position than two parents wholeheartedly agreeing. Although one family is coming into mind where the parents really did agree quite wholeheartedly, and one might think that the children would respond well and be well behaved, but they actually came in because the kids were out of control. As it happens, there were some very strong stressors in that family. This was a very anxious family under a lot of reality challenges, and so I think that was the overriding influence.
Mm-hmm. So truly being in agreement was not a problem. It is when you say you're in agreement, but you're really not as clear and you want to just support the other parent or have the support of the other parent.
Well, the part about supporting the other parent, what I see more often is really about, I don't want that other parent mad at me. I don't want this turned on me, so I'll sort of go along. But that's when that parent may go out, come back, and the kid is doing exactly what, I'll say she in this case, didn't want to happen. Oh, you are on your video game. Well, he was good tonight, so I gave him the video game. That's how that often plays out, the faux united front.
So in that case, what do you think is a better way of handling the situation?
Well, I like the way the story you described with the husband out in the car. You know, you've got this. I don't need to get involved in this. I have faith in you. And let it play out between the two.
Mm-hmm. As I was getting ready to prepare for this show, I was looking at some parenting websites, and they of course recommend just be in agreement. If you have a question about family policy, discuss it with your partner. If your partner makes a snap decision, you need to support it. If you make a snap decision, your partner needs to support it. As much as possible, avoid having one person make a unilateral decision. So that is what we are communicated, that is a good parenting. So how do you begin with your clients to see the other side of the coin, as I was saying in the introduction?
Well, the first question is always, is what you're doing working?
Okay.
Presumably they're coming in for a consultation because it's not.
Mm.
And of course, the initial story would be, well, if you would just listen to me and do it the way I want, then we wouldn't have this problem. But what if two people sincerely disagree? And again, at some point, that always will be the case. I think that's interesting. Try not to make unilateral decisions in real life with kids active, running around, things happening every minute. There's a lot of snap decisions that have to be made. Oh my goodness. It's impossible to use the remote and put the family on pause to go have a discussion in the bedroom, a nice, calm, cool, then come out and hit play and implement one's best thinking. I think that also just heightens the focus on the child as the problem in the family, where really children who are struggling are much more likely to be reflecting an anxious process in the entire family.
So this is about the parents.
Again, the parents, the marriage, yes.
Wow, it is about managing yourself as an adult in front of a situation where you are uncomfortable, something like that.
So that's what the Bowen theory term, differentiation of self, holding on to oneself, maintaining one's principles and thinking in the face of emotional turmoil, that's what that is. That's what that means, exactly.
And I guess it just makes me think that this is a great opportunity to exercise this capacity in a small doses. As the day goes by,
something came into my mind that parents often report that when the other spouse is away, the kids actually behave better. Mm. And so that's an interesting thought. What is different? A lot of energy, anxious energy, goes into trying to pull the other spouse along, which adds to the tension in the whole family, and the kids, of course, are picking that up and reacting to that. It's just an interesting thought that some people find parenting easier as a single parent because the brain isn't going, how come that one isn't helping me, letting me down, you know.
What is he thinking about, what I'm doing,
yeah,
being accepted or not,
yes,
and all those things.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So in terms of the theoretical ideas behind this recommendation, if you're going to call it recommendation, I don't, there's the triangle, there's differentiation of self, there's the projection on the child. Like, how would you summarize maybe what is behind it, what one can keep in mind? Because this is not a technique. It's not now you disagree and it's going to be better. It's about something more, something deeper.
It's a principle, mm-hmm, that if there's a relationship problem in my life, with any person in my life, I'm best off looking at it, first of all, rather than seeing the problem in the other person exclusively, my child is naughty, my child is misbehaving, to think in terms of there's a situation between us, I am part of it, that is not working out, mm-hmm, and what is my part in that? And of course I can learn a lot about my own automatic part in any situation by learning more about the family as a whole and the extended family and the home I was raised in. I can probably get a lot of clues about my own automatic and then my child's predictable automatic, and be in a better position to make modifications to my own handling of a scratchy situation between myself and a child in this case.
And the parent who's not cooperating, the other parent who's not cooperating, because that's where we look, right? This is not working because you are not helping me.
That's exactly right. This is not. This kid is acting up because you're, you don't have my back.
Mm-hmm.
And I just think about, you know, wait till your father gets home. I don't know that people say that as often as they used to. But right there, I've just told my kids, I'm not up to this job. I need that guy to come in and take over. And then he comes in and takes over, and he's probably aggravated after his long day, and I've stirred him up, and he's going to come in, and he's going to come in with too big of a hammer and blow the whole thing up and sort of prove that the kids are the problem.
Mm-hmm. Well, a lot to think about. I think it really turns things over and allows to look at a different perspective and not continue doing the same thing that is not working over and over again. Thank you for being here, Lorna.
Thank you for having me.
I'd like to remind you that the Bowen Center for the Study of the Family offers the community affordable psychotherapy. If you would like more information about the topic or the services at the Bowen Center, please visit the website at www.thebowencenter.org or send me an email at familymatters@thebowencenter.org. You can also find us on Facebook and Twitter or call 202-965-4400. Thank you for watching, and I invite you to join me again for another edition of Family Matters. I'm Dr. Mariana Martinez, and your family does matter.